In this video, we're computing the magnetic field within a toroidal coil. So what we've done here is take a solenoid with n turns of wire on it, and then bend it into the shape of a donut. That wire is carrying a current I, and we can see in the diagram that I is running down the outer side of the donut, which means it's running up the inner side of the donut as the current spirals around this torus. And of course, to calculate this magnetic field, we're going to use Ampere's law. So we have a little reminder of Ampere's law over here on the right. And that says the path integral of magnetic field along a closed loop is equal to mu naught times the current enclosed by that loop. In other words, the amount of current penetrating the surface defined by the loop. And if you need a quick Ampere's law refresher, I'll post a link to my derivation of Ampere's law up at the top. So to start things out, we're going to make a couple reasonable, but admittedly not very rigorous assumptions based on our previous experience with the long solenoid or coil of wire. In the previous video, we showed carefully that the magnetic field outside the long solenoid is zero. So it seems reasonable, at least as an approximation, to assume the field is zero outside the toroid as well, since it's just a solenoid bent into the shape of a donut. Next, we also showed that the field inside the solenoid is parallel to the solenoid axis. So again, we're going to say it's not too unreasonable to assume that when we bend the solenoid into a circle, that magnetic field is going to follow the axis of the circular cross-section. In other words, the magnetic field is going to be circumferential. So if you're buying those arguments, it's time to choose an Amperian loop within the interior of this toroid. So there's our circumferential Amperian loop hiding inside the three-dimensional image, but it's time to switch to a more schematic view of what's going on. So in the diagram, we're viewing the toroidal coil from above, and we're looking at this cross section where the toroid has been sliced through its symmetry plane. In other words, we cut it like a bagel instead of a donut. And I've reduced the number of turns of wire for the sake of visibility, and we can see the current diving into the page along the outer edge of the toroid. Those are the X's indicating into the page. And then the current is coming back out of the page along the inner edge of the toroid, and those are the dots with the circles around them indicating current out of the page. We've also labeled our Amperian loop with a radius of little r. Now the last thing we want to get done before applying Ampere's law is that we want to know which way the magnetic field actually points inside this thing. So we've already assumed that the field is circumferential, but we need to decide whether it's clockwise or counterclockwise through this toroid. And for that, we need a right-hand rule. So if we apply our right-hand rule to a couple of these wire cross sections, we just put our thumb in the direction of current, and the fingers of the right hand tell you the direction of the magnetic field swirling around the wire. So for the inward pointing current on the outer edge of the torus, we put our thumb pointing into the page, the fingers of the right hand curl around in the clockwise direction, and we get a little swirling clockwise contribution to the magnetic field. Notice that the part of that that's inside the torus has a component pointing in the counterclockwise direction around the torus. Then for the outward pointing current on the inner edge of the torus, we do the same thing, put our thumb in the direction of that current. The fingers of our right hand wrap around in the counterclockwise direction, which inside the torus itself again produces a counterclockwise component of magnetic field. Now our decision to make about the direction of field within the toroid is simply clockwise or counterclockwise because we assumed it's perfectly circumferential, and with each of these little swirling contributions having a counterclockwise contribution around the torus, we conclude that the field inside the torus is perfectly circumferential and counterclockwise. Now, just to be extra clear about what's going on in the path integral, here's the magnetic field vector as a vector at one particular point on the Amperian loop. So saying that B is circumferential and counterclockwise is the same as saying that the magnetic field vector is tangential to any circular path that shares the symmetry of the torus. So our little B vector is tangential at that point of interest in the diagram. And the path increment DL in our Ampere's law path integral is just a little segment of that circular Amperian loop. So that's going to be tangential as well and parallel to B. So now we're ready to proceed with our Ampere's law calculation. And this is actually pretty quick. We start with the path integral on the left-hand side, and that's the integral of B dotted into DL as we traverse this entire Amperian loop. And with B and DL pointing in the same direction, the dot product is trivial, and we simply get the product of the magnitudes of B and DL. Now, because that Amperian loop shares the symmetry of our toroidal coil, there's no way the magnitude of B could be changing along that circular Amperian loop. In other words, the magnitude of B is a constant, which means it can then be factored out of the integral. So we just get B times the path integral of DL itself. And the path integral of DL just says to add up all the length increments on this circle of radius little r, and that's just the circumference of the circle. So the left-hand side of Ampere's law reduces to just B times 2 pi r. Now what's going on the right side of Ampere's law? On the right-hand side, we have mu naught times I enclosed. So we just have to look at how much current is penetrating the surface defined by the Amperian loop. And the current captured inside this loop is all these little outward pointing contributions along that inner edge of the torus. And we were told there were N turns in the toroidal coil. That's capital N turns, each of them carrying a current of I. So our total current captured here is just the number of wires poking through this loop. That's big N times the current carried by each wire. So now we can put it all together. On the left-hand side, we had B times 2 pi R. And on the right-hand side, we have mu naught times capital N, the total number of turns in the toroidal coil, times I, the current carried by that wire. Now all we have to do is divide by 2 pi R. And so we arrive at the final answer for the magnetic field inside the toroid itself, and that's mu naught Ni over 2 pi R. So this gives us an interesting contrast with the solenoid. Remember, the long straight solenoid had a uniform magnetic field inside. No matter where we were inside that thing, it had the same magnitude of magnetic field. Not so with the torus, which actually drops off with distance to the center of the torus as 1 over r. This video is part of a series on Ampere's law and its applications, and I'll post a link to that playlist at the lower left of the end screen. In the next video, we're going to solve the simple coaxial cable, meaning that we consider the central wire of the coaxial cable to be very thin and the outer conducting foil to be very thin. I'll post a link to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.